Good morning, good morning, good morning. Good morning.
And also, don't forget to mark on your calendars Sunday, August 25th, which is coming up real quick. We're planning a special worship service and fellowship and possible baptisms at that time, which will be held on at Onekaha Beach. So if you come here that morning, you'll be standing at the closed door. So bring your swimsuits and be ready to have a lot of fun down at the beach and have some nice fellowship with us down there. Also, the schedule for meals for Auntie Debbie and Uncle Al are going to change. So Auntie Sandy will contact those who have already signed up and advise the church. Once you sign up, she'll let you know what is needed at that time. And we really want to mahalo all those that have signed up and those that are currently signing up for that. We really appreciate your help with that. All right, so let's go into prayer at this time. Our Heavenly Father, dear Lord, we thank you once again for a beautiful week. Dear Lord, thank you for this weekend, for the Kyokaha Regatta. Dear Lord, just for allowing us to fellowship with all of the paddlers. Lord, we thank you for this beautiful day as we begin our service today. Lord, we ask that you be with Uncle Jim as he gives your sermon this morning. Dear Lord, that you will just guide him in what he needs to say. Dear Lord, we thank you for this beautiful day. And Lord, we especially lift those that have been such a blessing to our church. Lord, we thank you for Auntie Debbie and all that she has continued to do for our church. We pray that you continue to heal her according to your will, dear Lord. We thank you for just letting her know that she's never alone, dear Lord. And we also pray for Uncle Al. We thank you for blessing us with his presence this morning. Lord, we pray that you continue to be with him as well, to comfort him, dear Lord. And we pray for all those that are suffering and being ill. We continue to pray for Auntie Charmaine's husband who is ill. And Lord, we just pray for continued healing upon his cancer. And Lord, all those that need you right now, dear Lord, we just pray that you will be so evident and present in their lives. Lord, we pray as we open this service this morning that we will just leave all of our troubles aside, dear Lord, and just lift you up and praise you fully, dear Lord, for the God that you are. We thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, we thank you for the sacrifice that he has made for us, that we are so undeserving of it. And so, Lord, we pray, dear Lord, that we may continue to exemplify his love through our service to others and for the love of our church. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Can you pull that picture up one more time? Beautiful, huh? We live in such a place. We live in such a place. That is God all around. Well, I hope you're ready. I hope you guys did your morning exercises and whatever it is that you need to get the blood flowing. Because we're going to definitely need it for this next song. Not sure there's a lot of people out there that are really going to stand up and praise God through shouting music. I'm so glad you walked over there to grab that thing. We're going to need that for this next song. But how fitting it is, with all the prayer requests going on, the song, the first line goes, I'm trading my sorrows, I'm trading my shames, I'm laying it down for the joy of the Lord. And whatever it is that you are going through in life, know that there's joy in the Lord in presence. Amen to that. So that being said, please rise as we sing, trading my sorrows. It's a good clap, good shout. And if you are just as melodious as my mom with her voice, there's a key for every song out there. Did we hit every valve in your body? Get that spirit going.
Thank you.
mic on?
Maybe a little louder. Today's message is about a relationship, your relationship with Jesus Christ. After studying the passage that we're going to look at today, which is 2 Peter in the first chapter, the first 11 verses, I've entitled the message, Your Faith, a Work in Progress. Before we move into that passage, let's bow for prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for every heart that's here. And I know, Lord, the fact that we're all here, there's a purpose that you have in mind for each of us. And as we study your word, I pray that you would speak to us individually in a mighty way, that we would hear your instructions in this passage from 2 Peter, that they would be applied to your to their lives, to each of our lives, so that we might be faithful to you, that we might be used, that our lives might be used for your purpose, not ours. We ask these things in Jesus' name, and everyone says,
Amen.
All right, here we go. Let's dive right into 2 Peter, first chapter, first 11 verses. Simon Peter, a servant and apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who through the righteousness of our God and Savior Jesus Christ have received a faith as precious as ours. Grace and peace be yours in abundance through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. His divine power has given us everything we need for a godly life through our knowledge of Him who called us by His own glory and goodness. Through these He's given us His very great and precious promises, so that through them you may participate in the divine nature, having escaped the corruption in the world caused by evil desires. And because of the nature of this passage, and because it gets so specific here, let's read the remaining verses together, beginning in verse 5. For this very reason, make every effort to add to your faith goodness, and to goodness, knowledge, and to knowledge, self-control, and to self-control, perseverance, and to perseverance, godliness, and to godliness, mutual affection, and to mutual affection, love. For if you possess these qualities in increasing measure, they will keep you from being ineffective and unproductive in your knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. But whoever does not have them is nearsighted and blind, forgetting that they have been cleansed from their past sins. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, make every effort to confirm your calling and election. For if you do these things, you will never stumble, and you will receive a rich welcome into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Well, this passage, or the book of 2 Peter, was written somewhere between 66 and 68 A.D. And there's other commentators and other biblical scholars, they say, no, it was written somewhere in the middle of the 2nd century. We'll let them argue about that. We don't need to be concerned with that, but just to let you know that. And it was the last book written in the New Testament, and the last book to gain entry into the canon of the New Testament scripture. And the entire book focuses on some internal problems that were occurring in the early Christian church. There were some false teachers that were creeping into the church at that time. And some of that false teaching involved promoting sexual sin. And some of them were advising believers not to keep the Ten Commandments. And those teachings were causing some believers actually to leave the church at that time. And so Peter was warning believers with this book about what would happen when he was gone, especially in terms of these teachings by false teachers. And in verse 13 of the 2 Peter 1, which we don't have up here on the screen, Peter indicates that his time on earth was limited because, and you can see why he was saying these things, because this book was written at the time when Nero was the emperor, the Roman emperor, who was in rulership at that time. And if you know anything about Nero, he was just more than happy to kill Christians on a moment's notice. He was a brutal guy, and he reigned between 68 and 54 AD. So this book was written probably just prior to the death of Peter, who was executed by Nero. Now, we don't know exactly who the book was written to, although 2 Peter, in the third chapter of 2 Peter, it mentions that Peter wrote a second letter to his audience. And if that was the same as the book of 1 Peter, then we know it was written to people in the various communities that comprise Asia Minor. Okay, let's look more carefully at this passage and kind of go through it verse by verse, which is loaded with information for us. And it also involves something that may put you to sleep, but it shouldn't. And that's kind of a word-for-word study. There is a great deal of words in here that are said, that are translated into English from the classical Greek, of course, in the New Testament. But those words in English are not, you can't appreciate them as much as if you hear some description of what they meant in classical Greek, and I'll do my best to try to convey that to you. So a part in verse 2, a part of Peter's initial greeting, his gracious offering of abundance, peace, and grace to the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. And the Greek word translated into English as knowledge in verse 2 is epignosis. And gnosis is a noun in classical Greek for knowledge, and epi is a preposition. So it's kind of two words brought together. And the with that understanding, epignosis can be further interpreted as knowledge which is always moving forward in the direction of what it seeks to know. And in this case, of course, it's seeking to know Jesus. And it also suggests that grace and peace become increasingly abundant as those who have a relationship with Jesus come to know him more and more. And when we, I don't know about you, but when you think of knowledge, I think of the learning that we receive in high school, or the knowledge that we receive perhaps in a college classroom or some online course. And we learn about various theories, scientific theories, maybe philosophy, maybe different concepts of life. And I kind of think of it as academic learning. And with that, knowledge, of course, in a relationship with Jesus, it does come from our study of God's Word that identifies the promises to those who believe and have a relationship with Him. We know the Word of God contains many instructions for daily living. It provides historical examples from the lives of many biblical characters, past and future prophecies, and more. But as we seek to know Jesus more and more, we apply those instructions that are found in the Word of God. That's what we're to be doing. We seek and we listen to the guidance of the Holy Spirit that is promised to all believers. Consequently, the knowledge of God and Jesus combines kind of that head knowledge, I'll call it, with practical application. In verse 3, Peter continues by telling us that God has given us everything we need for a godly life through our knowledge of Him, who called us by His own glory and goodness. So we may be students of the Word, and we may be doing the best we can to be a wonderful person, but what he tells us in this verse is that we need to understand it is God who invites us to have that relationship with Him. It's not how good we are, because that doesn't bring us the promise of eternal life. In verse 4, with God's invitation, He's has given us His great and precious promises so that you may participate in the divine nature. And of course, the promises are referring to the precious promises, the gift of forgiveness from what we have done wrong, the guidance of the Holy Spirit, eternal life, spiritual gifts, the meeting of our needs, and many more that are mentioned in the Word of God. And the divine nature is AKA for your relationship with Jesus Christ. It's the same thing. With our participation in the divine nature, our lives receive power and direction from God to live a life that is more obedient to God's instructions and more focused upon living, as we mentioned earlier, for God, not for ourselves. Let me kind of throw in an example from my own life. I was, as a baby, or as an infant, I was baptized in the Lutheran Church many moons ago. My parents were believers in Christ, and they made sure that I went with them to church every Sunday. I was in Sunday school. I went to the first 7 years of elementary school. We were in a Christian school that the church operated. So I had a pretty extensive Christian education, and I, like many of you, I participated in choirs. Guess what? I played my violin at church at that time, and I participated in many Christian youth activities, and so on. And then when I was 16, the Lutheran Church has something called confirmation, and that's a time where basically you repent of your sins, you recognize Jesus as your Savior. I recognize the presence and function of the Holy Spirit in my life, and I believe that I would receive the promise of eternal life. And with all that orientation at a young age, that led me to enter a pre-ministerial program in my freshman year of college, and I studied, took courses in the Vulgate, which is a 4th century Latin translation of the Bible, and that preceded the King James Version. I studied classical Greek for a couple semesters, took Bible classes, did all that, and as well as all the other electives that college freshmen would take. But after a couple of 20-plus credit hour semesters, I got off that train. And I then shifted my major into business administration. And then when I transferred then on to a 4-year university out on the West Coast, then I shifted into political science, where I graduated there. I bring all this up not to drag you through all my years of my youth for any reason, but to indicate, as I reflect back on all that, as much of a blessing as it was, a lot of it was head knowledge. You know how that feels? You memorize a lot of scripture. You're instructed about what it means, what it says. But I wasn't in regular communication with God and asking for His guidance in my life. So I was a believer who participated a little bit in the nature of God. And as we said before, a relationship with Jesus, your head knowledge, your academic learning, your study, needs to be combined with a practical day-to-day application. And my life was not. And that, I think, contributed, as I look back, on me eventually being led astray from my relationship with Jesus Christ. And that's, I don't point to my parents or point to college, that's me. That's the choices that I made. That I didn't do that. I didn't lose my relationship with Christ. I didn't lose those promises But my relationship with Jesus Christ was inactive. Anybody can relate to that when you have an inactive relationship with Jesus Christ? Yeah, you know all the things. You can say them in your sleep. You understand all of God's promises. You do all of that. But you really are not communicating with God on a day-to-day basis to let Him guide your life so that He can change you, so that you can become who He wants you to be, so that your life has a purpose beyond just material things. In verses 5, 6, and 7, now we get into the specifics that Peter points out. He provides very specific instructions. You can see them. Add goodness to your faith. Add knowledge to goodness. Add self-control to knowledge. Add perseverance to self-control. Add godliness to perseverance. Add mutual affection to godliness. And add love to mutual affection. And that list sounds kind of familiar, doesn't it? Those of you familiar with Galatians 5, 22 and 23, remember that one? But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there's no law. And then it's also somewhat familiar to a list that Paul transmitted to Timothy in 1 Timothy 6, verse 11. But you, man of God, flee from all this and pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, endurance, and gentleness. And I don't know about you, but I have a kind of a funny rule of thumb. But when you study the Word of God and you hear an instruction for God more than once, pay attention to it. Because here we're hearing it repeatedly in the Word of God. Well, our participation in the divine nature, or our relationship with God that's talked about in verse 4, it, of course, begins with faith. Yes, our belief in God's forgiveness, the gift of the Holy Spirit, the promise of eternal life. But our faith has got to include our trust in God that our relationship with Him really works. That it's not just happy talk that we talk about on Sundays. And if any of you here this morning are perhaps, and I think some of you are, new to the faith and a relationship with God, I can't help but think you may be wondering, but does that relationship, does that really work? You mean I'm going to really hear a message from God? I'm going to hear something? I'm going to feel something? If I communicate with God, will He get back to me like my friends who I text with? Will I get back that quickly? And how do you know if it works? Do we really know? Does that relationship really work? Study His Word. Speak to Him. Listen and watch for His direction. And do that over and over again. It's just like riding a bicycle. You may be shaky at first, but you'll eventually become more confident as you gain your balance. Do I hear an amen?
Amen.
Yeah, there's some people who've gone through this. Depending on what version of the Bible you're reading, the next characteristic that you are to add is goodness. Or if you're reading the King James Version, it might read virtue. And this English translation is derived from the Greek word arete, which means excellence. And it's a virtue, that kind of virtue is something that makes someone a good citizen, a good neighbor, a good friend. And the goodness we are to add knowledge. And this comes from the Greek word gnosis. In classical Greek, there are some words that have some similar translations in English, but they have entirely different meanings. One word is sophia, which actually you could translate to wisdom, but oftentimes is associated with knowledge. And again, I'm going to call that spiritual head knowledge. Gnosis, though, differs because it's a practical knowledge. It's the ability to apply the knowledge that we gain from Sophia, the wisdom of God, to specific situations in your life. Then add self-control to knowledge. Egrateia is the Greek word. That means the ability to get a grip on yourself. A couple weeks ago, I was playing tennis like I frequently do at Edith Kanakaoli Stadium. And I play about three times a week, and on that particular day, I was really trying to do my best to make really good volleys, you know, up at the net. I was trying to do some baseline shots that, you know, were good and fast and hard and well placed. I was trying to make some serves that kind of go like this so that you're there, the ball goes away from you. I was trying to do all these things, but I was so inconsistent. I'd make one serve and, yeah, I did this, just what I wanted. And then I'd do four more, and they were totally terrible. In fact, they fell into the net. So I was really, really getting, I was infuriated by this. And we were playing doubles, and my partner, he came up to me, and he quietly said, hey, Jim, we're just playing for fun, aren't we? Yeah, I was trying to, but I wasn't displaying any self-control. So that's what that Greek word means. Then add perseverance to self-control. Hupomone is the Greek word, and it means cheerful or hopeful, endurance, patience. A note and a nice biblical, to me, Bible study is the Blue Letter Bible online, if you've never used that before. It describes hupomone as the characteristic of a man who is not swerved from his deliberate purpose and loyalty to faith, even during the toughest times that you experience. Add godliness to perseverance, and this translation comes from the Greek word eusebeia, which means piety or holiness. But some commentators say that this word is almost untranslatable into English. One says that the man who has eusebeia always correctly worships God and gives him his due, but he also correctly serves his fellow man and gives them their due. To godliness add mutual affection. Your version of the Bible might use another word like kindness that we see in the King James Version. And the Greek word, and this one you'll be familiar with, is Philadelphia, which means the love of the brethren. Sound familiar? It should. Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, known as the city of brotherly love. And the final layer of this list of virtues is love that is added to mutual affection. And the Greek word is agape, one of four Greek words for love. And it's the strongest version of love. And Paul describes agape love in the passage, of course, found in the love chapter in 1 Corinthians 13, and just a few verses from that you're very familiar with, I'm sure. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It's not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. So there we have it. A recipe for a multi-layered cake of eight virtues for your life. Virtues that God wants you and I to incorporate into our life. You know, as you sit here today, you might, and you think about those eight virtues, you might be feeling pretty good about where you're at. You might just say, you know, those are, I see them in my life. I could give you a lot of examples, Jim, of where I've displayed that in my life. But there might be a few, maybe just one, that represents a challenge in your life. And that's why your faith is a work in progress. God desires you to change you to become more like Him. But why? You know, when God inspired Peter to write this book, he anticipated that question. Look at verse 8. For if you possess these qualities in increasing measure, they will keep you from being ineffective and unproductive in your knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. But whoever does not have them is nearsighted and blind, forgetting that they have been cleansed from their past sins. If these virtues characterize your life, you'll be effective and productive in your knowledge of Jesus Christ. And there's that word again, epignosis, the Greek word used for knowledge. We said that this word can be further interpreted as knowledge which is always moving closer in the direction of that which is you're seeking, which in this is the Lord Jesus Christ. God has a purpose for your life, and those eight virtues are characteristics that God wants displayed in your life and mine to distinguish your life from the lives of people who don't have a relationship with Jesus. You know, it occurs to me there's a bunch of us in this room that don't get out that much anymore. And so what people see from this, we may not be sharing our faith with people at work or at some other location because we're not there. We're at home, or maybe some people visit us, or there's an extended family gathering. And what people are looking at is how we do what we do, how we respond to different situations. I know one of my stepsons said to me recently, he says, the reason I don't have that relationship with Jesus that you and Mom keep talking about is that I see a lot of Christians walking around that don't do it. Don't do those instructions that you say are in the Word of God. That's true, isn't it? We don't see that. That's a lame excuse on his part. And there are consequences for him resting his life future on the conclusion. So grace and peace become increasingly abundant as those of us who have a relationship with Jesus come to know Him more and more. So if we want our lives to move further in that direction, and to know Him more and more, we should be all over these virtues in all aspects of our lives. In whatever we do and say, they are not going to give you salvation. You're not going to work your way to salvation by incorporating these virtues in your life. But verse 9 says that if you have a relationship with Jesus and you simply blow them off as unnecessary, or a low priority for your life, you simply have forgotten that Jesus died on the cross for the forgiveness of everything you've done wrong. And bluntly speaking, it's telling us you have become spiritually nearsighted and blind. So what's that mean when you're nearsighted? I'm nearsighted. Harder to see in the the distance isn't. Or we could say you've kind of lost sight of the big picture of your relationship with Jesus. And if you do, the irony is this. Here's the great irony that just hit me this week as I studied this passage. You're more than happy to accept the gift of forgiveness. You're more than happy to receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. You're more than happy to receive the promise of eternal life. But you just can't seem to find the time to pursue those virtues with the guidance of the Holy Spirit. Boy, that hit me this week. Amen. Verse 10, therefore, my brothers and sisters, make every effort to confirm your calling and election. For if you do these things, you will never stumble, and you will receive a rich welcome into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So if you incorporate those virtues in your life, you will never stumble. What's that mean? This instruction suggests that you will not fall away from your relationship with Jesus Christ. Sure, you're not going to have a completely virtuous life. You're a sinner, just like me. But you'll remain on the path that He instructs us to take on our spiritual journey. And ultimately, you will receive a rich welcome into the eternal kingdom of Christ. Now that sounds really exciting. Amen? I haven't read that too many places in the Word of God where you're going to receive a rich welcome. So it's one thing to say the wonderful gift of eternal life, but you're going to get a rich welcome. I love it. So as you consider these instructions in this passage, I think I can hear the sighs of frustration. Oh, Jim, if you only knew my life. I'm working full time to just keep my head above water financially. 45 cents a kilowatt hour on electric power. Woo! And by the way, I've got kids. They've got soccer practice. We've got gymnastics. We've got all this stuff going on. My wife has a honey-do list that's a mile long that I haven't been, and she keeps giving me that look. My husband always wants me to go do something, but he says it's the weekend and we never go out. My yard demands me to be out there at least every 10 days or 2 weeks. And you want me to add more things to my life? You want me to add these 8 virtues? Something else I've got to work on in addition to all that? And then there's some of you that might say, hey, Jim, I've worked the last 50 years of my life. The last 50 years. And I am retired. I play some golf, yeah. I also go play some pickleball with my wife. I hang out with friends, and yes, certainly. Sometimes we take a trip here and there. And I'm finally doing things that I've always wanted to do for a long time. Got it. But the incorporation of those virtues in your life does not represent a new set of tasks for you to take on. They simply refine the way you do what you are already involved with. And if you tell me this morning after the service this morning that none of those virtues can play into what you're doing, take a look at what you're doing. What happens when you incorporate these virtues in your life is you become more intentional with how you do what you're already doing. They provide you with the best life insurance you can buy. You will never fall from your relationship with God. Your participation in your relationship with Jesus Christ will make you more effective. It'll make you more productive in your service to the Lord Jesus Christ. And by the way, don't forget that rich welcome. I'm not sure what that means, if you get coffee and donuts or whatever when we're coming into the eternal life. But it's something I really like the way that sounds. It doesn't get much better than that, a rich welcome. When's the last time you had a rich welcome anywhere? So, yes, your faith, your relationship in Jesus Christ is a work in progress. Trust Him as He guides you, and watch what happens. Your life will be used for His glory, for His purpose. Amen. Time, if you see it, you're looking at your bulletin, you say, now what? What's going on now? This is the altar call. You know, when I was preparing this message, I had thought I'd finished kind of what I thought was my first cut of the message. And I was studying another passage in the Word of God, and I ran into this one. Matthew 7, verse 24. Let's read that together. Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock. That's the words of Jesus on the Sermon on the Mount. He wants your life to be built upon Him. He's the rock of our salvation. He's the rock of every day in your life if you have that relationship with Him. And you not only have the relationship, but it's on active, it's not inactive. It's something that you have that relationship, you go back and forth. You know, I've been trying to figure out what's an analogy between an inactive and active relationship. It's kind of like you went and you got married one day, and you both had your wedding vows, and you both committed that you'd be there through sickness and health and all that stuff in your life, and then you got back from the honeymoon and you said, okay, honey, whatever you do, whatever, that's fine. I'm doing my thing. And this is the whole point of the relationship. So as you reflect on the eight virtues that we talked about this morning that Peter points out in 2 Peter 1, how many of those virtues are missing in your life? Or maybe they're lacking. Or maybe in some cases they're missing in your life. And if any are, God wants you and I to turn to Him to lead our lives. And it begins with faith. And perhaps faith in God is something that you grew around. You don't mind coming to church, you don't mind hearing singing the songs, you don't mind the prayers and all that. But having a relationship with Jesus is maybe just something you say, hey, wait, that's going a little bit too far. And God is here saying to us, as we learn from this passage and others, that He wants us to be in His family and that we would rely upon Him. This morning, if you sense that God is speaking to you, as we do every Sunday, I invite you to come forward so that we might pray for you. And if you say, well, hey, I'm not really into coming up in front of all these people and talking about where I'm at and all that. The deacons are here. How many of you are deacons? If you're a deacon, raise your hand. You are able to speak to the deacons in this church, be able to approach them and ask them about questions you might have about what is having a relationship with Jesus Christ? What do you mean having a faith in Him? And so feel free to let them, they are available to listen to your situation and what might be the desires of your heart. And there's maybe others this morning that are have a new faith in Jesus, or maybe it's a faith you've had for a long time, but you've never been baptized. If that's something that's on your heart this morning, again, that's something we ask that you would come and speak to the deacons after the service today. And others of you may be seeking a church membership, and if you are, we would love to have you either come forward today or speak to any of our deacons about that. And in addition to all that, there may be other issues that are happening in your life. Things that you don't know what to do. How many have ever been in that situation? You just flat out don't know what to do with what you face. Come on. Come on. How many of you ever faced that situation? Boy, you guys are wise people. You understand what to do. I did many times. And so feel free to come forward with that. Let's sing now. Join us in singing our closing song.
Father, thank you for today's message. You know, Father, for those who are listening from afar, and for those who couldn't make it tonight, I would just continue to lift up your hands. Father, we continue to pray for our church, for your strength and wisdom and guidance in our own name. We give all of us to the end of this opportunity, and all of us that pray in Jesus Christ. Amen.